Television, the way we watch it and what we watch in many ways was shaped back in the 1960s by a man named Newt Minow, a distinguished lawyer. He served as the chairman of the Federal Communications Commission. He's also been part of every televised presidential debate since 1960. He's 94 years old, still practicing law, and he sat down with us last week to talk about TV, politics, his relationship with John F. Kennedy, and the two words he used in a speech that are still quoted today, almost 50 years later. Newt, it would take us probably an hour to go over half of your accomplishments, but if you could pick one, what, in your opinion, is the most meaningful or important to you?
Well, I think it was the experience I had with President Kennedy when he appointed me chairman of the FCC, and I had a chance to play a role in the development of television, of communication satellites, of public television, enhancing commercial television. And of course, the most important thing to me always is my own family.
Well, despite the many accomplishments, Newt, a lot of people will remember you for the famous speech you gave in 1961 to the NAB.
I invite each of you to sit down in front of your own television set when your station goes on the air and stay there for a day without a book, without a magazine, without a newspaper, without a profit and loss sheet or a rating book to distract you. Keep your eyes glued to that set until the station signs off. I can assure you that what you will observe is a vast wasteland.
You used two words to describe the offerings of American television: vast wasteland.
Well, the two words I wanted to be remembered by were two different words. The two words I cared about were public interest.
You think the speech was misunderstood?
People think I didn't like television. I happen to be a television junkie and love television, and I just wanted it to be better and to better serve the American people, and particularly to better serve children.
What was the response to the speech?
Well, I think there was great approval by the general public. We got more mail than ever in the history of the FCC.
Did you hear from President Kennedy after the speech?
No, but I heard from his father the night of the speech. His father, Ambassador Joseph Kennedy, I got a call, and this is the White House calling. He said, "Newt, that was the best speech since my son's inaugural." He said, "You just keep it up. Anybody gives you any problems, you call me. Goodbye."
Knowing what you know now, if you could go back to 1961 and make a change that would impact how we watch TV today, is there anything you would do?
Yeah, I would have done something that's been done in most other countries. Broadcasters themselves have a code of 6 minutes an hour for commercial time. I tried, without success at the FCC at the time, Congress actually said no, I would have put that limit into the law.
We found a picture of you and your wife, Jo, and your three girls in the Oval Office with JFK. In my research for this interview, Newt, I never heard you talk about the assassinations of JFK or Bobby. Do you mind if I ask you about that, the impact on you?
Fine. I still haven't recovered from it, but I think that we lost two great hopes for the future of our country.
The conventions are behind us. Up next, we have the debates, and you're considered the father of the modern-day presidential debate. Why were those so important to you when you pitched them to Adlai Stevenson back in the 1950s?
Well, I felt that television and radio enabled the American people to learn more about the candidates than any other means. They'd have firsthand, direct contact with the candidates. Also, in 1956, President Eisenhower had suffered a bad heart attack in 1955, and I felt that it was foolish for him to keep running around the country breathlessly as a traditional candidate. So I suggested that Stevenson and Eisenhower have a series of joint appearances through radio and television, and thus permit the American people to participate in learning the issues and learning about the candidates. That didn't happen in 56, but in 1960, Kennedy-Nixon debates.
Right, and you've been a part of every televised debate since then. But let's go back to that 60 debate, because that one turned in the end, as we know, not on what something the candidate said, but on the way they looked.
Kennedy was not as well known as Nixon. Nixon was vice president. The country had known him for 8 years in the White House with President Eisenhower. Kennedy was young, and what he convinced the country, I think particularly in that first debate, was that he was a grown-up, that he understood the issues, and he had the character and the intellect to be qualified to be president.
It also showed the power of television, though.
Many people who listened to the Kennedy-Nixon debate on the radio thought that Nixon had won. Many people who watched it on television thought Kennedy had won.
Is there a better way to do them, do you think? Perhaps where the two candidates actually debate one another without anyone else involved?
I would much prefer that. The legal aid of voters would prefer that. The Commission on Presidential Debates would prefer that. Candidates don't want to do that.
President Obama awarded you the Medal of Freedom, and you were in some very impressive company, from the sports and science worlds to movie and music. What do you remember about that day?
Well, my kids were most anxious to meet stars of music and television. I was happy to meet Bill Gates and his wife. I was very happy. I'm a great fan of Tom Hanks, and I had the great pleasure of meeting him. Turned out, sadly for me, it was November 22nd, which was the anniversary of President Kennedy's assassination. So I had that in my mind, being in the White House that day, too.
What we're trying to do here, Newt, with News Nation is a bit unique at this time, but it sounds a lot like the kind of program you were calling for in 1961. Do you think it'll work?
I think playing the news straight, and you should be skeptics, not cynics. I emphasize that. I think because of Vietnam, because of Watergate, too many journalists became cynics rather than skeptics. You should be skeptical. You should hold the government accountable, but not be cynical about people's motives or what they are trying to do.
What a fascinating man.
Wow.
And there's another interesting pop culture note for him. You remember Gilligan's Island? We all do, right? The three-hour tour. Do you remember the name of the boat?
The SS Minnow.
So the creator of the show was so upset with Newt's speech that he named the ill-fated boat after Newt Minow. So that's how it came about. But they patched things up a little bit later on, Newt told me. And he ended up with one of the life preservers from the SS Minnow, which is now on display at the Chicago History Museum. But what a treasure and what an honor to chat with Newt Minow.
That is just fascinating. And it's so important that we listen to those stories from the past because they help us live in the present and prepare for the future. And right now we need that. So it was great to hear him tell those stories.
Yeah.
Good job, Joe.
Thank you.